Welcome to Water Balance of River Basins. My name is Andreas de Jong. Did you know that the water lost to evaporation from all the reservoirs in the world is estimated to exceed the entire domestic and industrial water demand? So why is it that this very important water loss is so rarely addressed in river basin management plans or still the cost-benefit analysis for new dams? The reason is that it is incredibly difficult to estimate how much water is lost to evaporation. In today's video, I'm going to show you a quick, easy and free way to make this estimation. I hope you enjoy it. We'll use the Kajaki Reservoir in Afghanistan as an example and compare our results to the hydrological modeling work done by the USGS. This video has 7 sections. We'll quickly review the main components of a reservoir water balance. Then I'll show you where to get free precipitation and evaporation data. From this data, we'll calculate the net evaporation rate and also the monthly evaporation losses from the Kajaki Reservoir. Then we will evaluate the economic impact of evaporation losses by comparing them to domestic and irrigation water demand in Afghanistan. All you need is access to the internet and MS Excel. Before we begin, a quick reminder of the key water balance components of a reservoir. The water balance of a reservoir is mostly controlled by the amount of water entering through inflows and leaving through outflows. There may also be some interaction with the local groundwater if permeable rocks are in contact with the reservoir. In today's video, we'll be estimating how much water is lost due to evaporation from the reservoir surface to the atmosphere. There will be also some precipitation which falls directly on the reservoir surface, and this needs to be removed from evaporation in order to estimate the net evaporation. We'll assume that there's no field data available, and also that in any case we don't have any time or budget to collect any new data. We'll get our evaporation data from the MOD16 dataset of MODIS and our precipitation data from the CHIRPS dataset. Let's begin with CHIRPS precipitation. You can download CHIRPS from the Climate Engine app. Please have a look at my video on how to do this, if you have not yet already seen it. For the project area, you don't have to be too accurate. So just draw a rectangle over the main reservoir area. Note that CHIRPS has data going back over the past 40 years or so, but we'll just get the data from the year 2000 to the last full calendar year. What we're looking for is the monthly average precipitation in millimeters. There's a bit of processing to do. Please check out my CHIRPS video and download the Excel spreadsheet template to help you with the calculations. The next thing we need to do is to get the potential evapotranspiration rates. For this, we'll use the MODIS MOD16A2 gap-filled product via the AppEEARS app. Please see my evaporate transpiration video on how to do this. As with the CHIRPS precipitation data, just draw a rectangle over the main reservoir area and download the data from the year 2000 to the last complete calendar year. Note that you need to include some land areas around the reservoir for this to work, as MODIS does not calculate evaporation from water surfaces. What we're looking for are the average monthly potential evapotranspiration rates. There's a bit of processing to do. Please check out my MODIS evapotranspiration video and download the Excel spreadsheet template to help with the calculations. The next step is to calculate the net evaporation rates. Here are the average monthly precipitation and potential evaporation rates for the Kajaki Reservoir area based on satellite data from the past 22 years. The annual precipitation is around 200 mm, while potential evapotranspiration is over 2.5 meters, which is quite typical of hot, arid regions. When water evaporates from the reservoir surface, a layer of humid air will build up, which will slow down the evaporation rate. If there's some wind, this layer of humid air will be blown away, and evaporation rates will increase. However, the wind itself will start to become more humid as it blows over the surface of the reservoir, which will again reduce the evaporation rate. What this means is that it is unlikely that actual evaporation rates from a reservoir surface can reach 100% of the potential evapotranspiration rates. So we need to reduce the potential evaporation rates to simulate the actual evaporation rates. The USGS did some research in the wetland Everglades of South Florida, and they found that actual evaporation from open water was 80% of potential evapotranspiration rates. So this is the magic number we will use. So to estimate the actual evaporation rate from the reservoir surface, we multiply the monthly PET rate by 0.8 and remove any precipitation. Here's a summary of the annual numbers. Evaporation is 2,116 millimeters. Precipitation is 197 millimeters. This gives us a net annual evaporation rate of 1,919 millimeters. So how does this compare with other studies? In 2007, the USGS published a report on the Kajaki Reservoir. I'll leave a link in the description below this video. In Table 2, you can see the precipitation and PET data used in their simulations. So here's a comparison chart. The USGS data is in blue and our data is in green. I'm quite happy with the result because both datasets are quite similar. The differences between the data is because they're based on different methodologies. Our approach is based on satellite measurements of the Kajaki Reservoir area, while the USGS study is using data from individual weather stations in southern Afghanistan, which may or may not be representative of the Kajaki area. The next step is to calculate the monthly volume of water lost to evaporation from the reservoir. We estimate that the net evaporation rate of the Kajaki Reservoir is around 1,900 mm per year, which is equivalent to 1.9 meters per year. To convert that into a volume, we also need to know the area of the reservoir. The volume of water evaporated equals the reservoir area times by the height of water evaporated. This may sound like a simple calculation, but what makes it complicated is that the reservoir area is never static. It is constantly changing as the volume of water in the reservoir is either increasing or decreasing during the year. Let's pick the water year October 2018 to September 2019, as it is representative of the full range of reservoir volumes. We'll use the average surface area of the reservoir for each month as an input to our volume calculations. On the right, you can see the reservoir storage in MCM, that's million cubic meters, and the calculated water levels in meters and surface area in square kilometers. Note that there's quite a long polynomial formula which does the calculations. The blue highlighted cells indicate that during April and May, the reservoir water levels were probably higher than the spillway. In other words, the reservoir was filled to full capacity. If you're interested in how to derive the polynomial formulas in Excel, please have a look at my previous video. I'll leave a link in the description below this video. First, we need to calculate the precipitation on the reservoir surface. We divide the CHIRPS precipitation by 1000 to convert it to meters, and then multiply it by the reservoir surface area. Note that the area is in square kilometers, so first multiply it by 1 million to convert it into square meters. We want our answer in MCM, so divide everything by 1 million. So we end up with 7.7 MCM of precipitation on the reservoir surface for the water year 2019. Next, we need to calculate the actual evaporation losses from the reservoir surface. So we multiply the MODIS PET by 0.8 to get the actual evaporation rates. Then we divide it by 1000 to convert it to meters and multiply it then by the reservoir surface area in meters. We want our answer in MCM, so divide everything by 1 million. We end up with 98.7 MCM of actual evaporation from the reservoir surface for the water year 2019. Finally, we take the actual evaporation and remove the precipitation. So we end up with 91 MCM of net evaporation from the reservoir surface for the water year 2019. Here's a chart of the average monthly volume of precipitation and evaporation of the Kajaki Reservoir in MCM. Evaporation always exceeds precipitation, and during the summer months, evaporation losses peak at 15 MCM per month. What this means is that any precipitation which falls on the reservoir surface will be evaporated, in addition to a lot of water taken from the reservoir storage itself. Here's a summary of the annual numbers. Evaporation, 98.7 MCM. Precipitation, 7.7 MCM. This gives us a net annual evaporation loss of 91 MCM. let's go to Lashkaka City, which is on the Helmand River downstream of the Kajaki Reservoir. The blue cube represents the estimated net amount of water loss to evaporation in the water year 2019 from the Kajaki Reservoir. 91 mcm is a cube of water approximately 450 by 450 by 450 meters in size. So what would happen if we let this water flood the entire city of Lashkaga? The city would be covered by 3.7 meters of water. That's twice my height. Clearly, this is a lot of water lost to evaporation. How can we quantify the economic impact of evaporation losses? Let's do some quick calculations. If we assume a minimum daily urban water demand of 60 liters per capita per day, that makes 21,900 liters per capita per year. If we divide the annual net evaporation losses by the per capita water demand, we end up with over 4 million people. This means that the water loss to evaporation each year from the Kajaki Reservoir is equivalent to the urban water demand of over 4 million people, assuming 60 liters per capita per day. Let's have a look at irrigation. We will assume an annual irrigation water demand of 22,000 meters cubed per hectare. This is calculated from a crop water demand of 8,000 cubic meters per hectare per year, 25% conveyance losses in the canals, followed by a field application efficiency of 50%. We can calculate what these evaporation losses means in terms of irrigated area. The water lost to evaporation each year from the Kajaki Reservoir could be used to irrigate over 4,000 hectares of land. That's equivalent to 40 square kilometers. What is the value of 91 mcm of water lost to evaporation? If we assume that the domestic water supply is worth half a dollar per cubic meter, then 91 mcm would have a value of over $45 million. If we assume that the minimum net benefit of irrigated agricultural land is $500 per hectare, then 4,136 hectares would be worth over $2 million per year. Of course, some of this water would have evaporated anyway if the dam did not exist, from the river and its floodplain inside the current reservoir area. Let's assume that this would have been 10% of current evaporation losses. So we can reduce the estimated economic losses to $2 million if all the water was used for agriculture, or $40 million if all the water was used for urban water supply. Obviously, the real number must be somewhere in between, depending on how the water is divided between drinking water and irrigation needs in the Helmand Basin downstream of the Kajaki Dam. And now for some conclusions to summarize what we've learned today. Evaporation losses from reservoirs are significant and should be included in all basin water balance studies and cost-benefit analysis of new reservoirs. These losses can easily be quantified using free data from CHIRPS precipitation, MODIS evaporation, and reservoir surface areas. Thanks so much for your attention. I hope that you found this video interesting and useful. If you have any questions, please leave a comment in the description below. I hope to see you on the next video.